So photovoltaic effect has a very long history, and what I want to do in this couple of videos is to present you a brief timeline, or summarize some of the very key events which happened in this field. And this is by no way a comprehensive summary. In fact, it's a very long history, as I said, and there have been many developments in this field. So I just want to present a few key events which happened. So the very first photovoltaic effect, the very first observation of photovoltaic effect, the discovery of the photovoltaic effect, was done in 1839, and it's credited to this gentleman Edmund Becquerel, who was a French physicist, and he was a child prodigy so as well. And at the age of 19, while working with his father, he discovered this photovoltaic effect. So the experiment that he performed, I'm showing it over here. So he in fact observed this for electrolytes, and he had this equipment where he was essentially measuring this voltage across these two electrodes, and he was shining light on one of these electrodes, and he measured a potential difference when you shine light on one of these electrodes. So this was the first discovery of photovoltaic effect, but this was not a solid state device. In fact, this was a electrolytic solution. So the first demonstration of what you can call a solid state photovoltaic effect in a solid state device, and a first solar cell made of a semiconductor, could be credited to this gentleman, Charles Fritts, and he was an American inventor, and he was experimenting with selenium. And a lot of the early demonstration of solar cells were done in this material, selenium, but this was one of the semiconductor materials which you could get your hands around easily in those days. Remember, this is 1883, and the processing technology for silicon hasn't been developed yet. So the way Charles Fritts designed his experiments was he sandwiched a thin layer of selenium. He sandwiched this thin layer of selenium between two different between metals of two different work functions. So he took a metal plate which was made, for example, of brass, and then he placed this sheet of selenium which was in thickness between 25 to 100 to 125 micron, and then on the top he basically placed this very thin sheet of gold on the top. And when he then subsequently shone light on top of this device, you could measure a photovoltaic effect, and you could in fact extract a reasonable amount of electrical energy out of this solar cell. So just to illustrate how this solar cell might work, so this is a Schottky contacted solar cell. So you have this semiconductor which is selenium, and I'm drawing this band diagram of selenium. So it has the conduction band and let's say a valence band, and now you're placing a semiconductor material, gold, which has a higher work function on the top, and then you're placing another semiconductor material which has a different work function at the bottom. So the built-in voltage in this junction is essentially coming from the difference in the work function between these two metals. So it's not a junction based solar cell as we will see later, but it's a Schottky contact based solar cell, and the built-in voltage is essentially resulting from this difference in the work function of these two metals. But nonetheless, the efficiency of these solar cells which were made out of selenium was very poor. In fact, most of these solar cells in those days had efficiencies of less than 1%. So the next big breakthrough in terms of efficiency came around in 1954, and it's credited to this trio of these three people who used to work at Bell Labs, and shown here is Pearson, Chapin and Fuller. And in fact, there's an interesting, background story behind this. So Chapin was the original solar energy enthusiast, and he was pursuing this research of solar cells based on selenium. And Pearson was a good friend of Chapin, and he persuaded him to, look at this other material called silicon, which was being developed for especially for transistors around the same time in 1954 at the same place in at Bell Labs. And he introduced him to Fuller, who was essentially another scientist working on silicon, especially doping of silicon. So he, they together and with, using the help of Fuller, who was an expert in doping these layers of silicon very precisely using using phosphorus or boron. So they came up with this design where Fuller essentially took an N-type wafer and then he uniformly doped it p-type, in a furnace, kind of a doping process where it was doped on all sides using this boron doping, and then essentially it formed this p-n junction at the very near to the surface. And then essentially they etched out the p region for a small portion, and then they made a contact to the n region. They also made a contact to the p region. And then when you shine light from the top, of course this device will generate solar energy. An interesting point to note is that this device is a all back contact solar cell, or both the contacts are located at the back of the device. And this is interesting. This we'll come back to this later, and we'll discuss that, some of the most efficient cells made in silicon also need to realize this back contact to avoid effects of shadowing, etc. But so this device, when this was measured and optimized, this could achieve efficiency of close to 6%, which was a big jump from the previous selenium-based solar cells, which had an efficiency of less than 1%. So this was again, so Bell Labs made a big announcement about this invention, and this is one of the photographs that I'm borrowing from their archives. And it's interesting to note that people used to wear scientists used to wear coats and tie at that time to work, which is something I haven't seen recently. The culture of dressing in labs at least has changed. And then they made a they made a you know as they try to generate some press publicity around this invention. So this is one of the images that was published in one of the popular magazine, again by popularized by Bell Labs. And it's showing this family having this solar panel, and it all seems very blissful, sunlight coming in. And there was a big article in New York Times announcing this invention in 1954. And I'm borrowing an excerpt from that article, and it proclaimed that this is a beginning of a new era, and leading to eventually to the realization of mankind's one of the most cherished dreams of mankind, that is to harness the almost limitless energy of the sun for use of civilization. Of course, this article claimed that that might be the eventual future, but we are not there yet. And I'll continue in the next video why it took so long for adoption of this solar cell into mainstream technology.